Okay, Tamas. So, not all of the students are in their place, but anyway, we will start, I think, on schedule.
Okay.
And it is time right now. So, please introduce yourself and go ahead. The room is yours.
Okay, thank you very much. Good morning, everyone. I'm having the last presentation before the lunch break. For you guys, it's just before noon, if I'm right. But here it's quite morning, it's 9:15. But let's get into this and go through and talk about the validation in aerodynamics. I picked this topic because I was the design judge in four competitions this year. The Formula Student Easter, which was some kind of preseason event with mostly Hungarian teams, but also with some foreigner teams from the neighborhood. That was besides that, I was a judge on Formula Student East as well, on our big competition, and also an aerodynamics judge in Formula Student Russia and in Formula Student Alpe Adria. And throughout these events, I noticed that after this 1 year break because of the COVID in 2020, the teams coming back are not really familiar with the basic validation ideas of aerodynamics. So I thought about to talk a little bit in this topic. In the beginning, I'm going to introduce myself very briefly because I was introduced in the previous years as well. But we're going to go through and my connections to former student and aerodynamics judging. And then we're going to talk about why do we need validation, what is the difficulties of these validations, met techniques, and then we're going to discuss about V-tunnel testing, but also on-site tests. And throughout the presentation, feel free to ask questions and be interactive. We can talk even during the presentation, but also at the end, we're going to have some time for questions and answers. And if we're going to have some time in the end, I'm going to talk about some extra topic, which is my current employer and my current work. So my name is Tamás Lenart, and I was a team member in former student at Technical University of Budapest from 2012 and to 2014. After I finished participating in the team, I immediately started to be a judge, a design judge, and later an organizer for former student East. On former student East, since the beginning, since 2016, I'm responsible for the organization of the engineering design event. But besides that, I also participate in former student competitions. I appeared in former student Russia in the past 3 years, so some of you may already know me from there, but also I'm usually a judge at former student East, and also lately in former student Alpe Adria, which is a competition held in Croatia. I participate that because I'm Hungarian, I'm from Hungary, but currently I'm living in Croatia, in Zagreb, because I work for a company called Rimac Automobili. I joined this in 2018, and I'm working in the vehicle engineering department. And although I'm going to talk about the aerodynamics today, but according to my job, I'm working on the electrical system, on the integration of the electrical system into vehicles. It means that we are locating electrical components, boxes in the car, and designing the wiring harness, connecting the devices. If we're going to have some extra time at the end of the presentation, I'm going to talk about the company and about my job in a bit deeper details. But now let's get back to the aerodynamics and talk about the importance of validation. So why do we need to validate? First and foremost, this is obviously the validation is a very key point of all the design work, because we need to design something and build something. And once it's built, we need to check, we need to test it if it's working as we planned it to work. Because this is the most important feedback that we need to get throughout our design process, that whatever we designed, it's working according to our design or not. If it's working according to the design, then it's good. If it's not working, then we need to investigate that where did we make the mistake, why the things are not doing what we designed them to do. Besides that, of course, it's important to present your job on the competitions. And in this case, you need to present it for the engineering design event judges. And judges likes to ask about validation because that shows the differences between a good or a bad team. Because a well-organized team will schedule the season like that, that they're gonna have sufficient time for testing and validation. And a little bit messier team might have some problems with the schedule, have some delays, and they're not gonna have time for proper validation. So if the judge is asking about the validation process and the testing of the car, that can really shows what the team managed to pull out throughout the year. Because of course, every team will have the design basics well documented and written down, because at the beginning of the season, everybody dedicates time for that. But when the problems come in, that's the testing part of the season. So if the testing and the validation is done properly, that's a clear indicator of the well done job of the team. Also, in case of aerodynamics, the tricky part with the validation is that it can really happen. While if you make a big mistake throughout the chassis design or the suspension design, and you're not gonna design a part which is gonna work, that's gonna break. And that will be a clear indicator of the failure. The broken suspension rod or the broken insert in the monocoque, or some clear indicators that what you did is not working well and you need to fix it. Of course, if you are over designing something and it's too thick, it's too strong for the given loads, that's not gonna break, so there will be no indicator of failure, but you're gonna see that it's sufficiently bigger than for other teams. And then you can think that, okay, why did we design a suspension rod with a 20 millimeter diameter, while others are just doing it with 15. But in case of aerodynamics, it can easily happen that you are designing an aerodynamic package, you apply it on the car and you run with it, and it can happen that it is working terribly. It doesn't generate the sufficient downforce, but it's adding an incredible amount of drag, and you're not gonna notice it if you are not doing some measurements. So it can really easy to go into some kind of dead ends where you design something, you manufacture something, and what you manufacture is not at all working according to the design, but you're not gonna notice it if you're not measuring it. For example, in this case, this is a GFR car, Global Formula Racing, a few years ago. In the 2015, 16, 17, they were the peak of, they were the strongest team in combustion category, and they had a massive, aggressive aerodynamics package. And by just looking at it, you cannot say that, okay, this side wing is looking like it's very, very hard angle and probably is generating a drag rather than creating a downforce. But it's something that you cannot say by looking at it. It needs to be measured, because something that looks like that it can work, it can happen that it's not working at all. And something which looks extreme and probably not working, it can happen that if it is designed that way and is designed well and is doing its job just as it's designed to do. So because of that, you do need aerodynamic validation, but there are clear problems with that. The difficulties of aerodynamic validation, sometimes it can be a bad attitude from other design areas that back then when the wings started to come into Formula Student, there were a big discussion between team members if it's worth to put the effort into it or does it give you the benefit? It's very slow speed, so it doesn't generate the sufficient downforce. But the aero guy said that it does, even in this speed of 50, 60, 70 kilometers an hour, it is generating a significant downforce. There were a lot of doubts about that. Some people thought that putting effort into manufacturing this huge carbon parts is pointless. We should rather focus on improving the suspension or improving the chassis, because those are the ones which are necessary for the car to run. And another argument that the car can run without the aerodynamics package. Of course, it's true. The aerodynamics package is not a functionally critical component like the drivetrain or the chassis or the suspension. Without these components, the car will not be able to run. without the aerodynamics, it will be able to run, but to be competitive and to extend your knowledge and learn and to make the best car. The best cars now in Formula Student have huge aerodynamics packages. They are relying on downforce. So if you want to be competitive, aerodynamics package is also something that you're going to need. Of course, as I said, sometimes it's getting less priority because it's not functionally critical, but teams need to take this into account and allocate proper testing time, not just for the other components, but also for the aerodynamics. And now we're going to talk about easy validation processes, which doesn't require too much time. And probably it can be done even in 1 or 2 days throughout the testing season. And that should be something that it should be possible to fit into a tight test schedule to dedicate at least 1 or 2 days for aerodynamics validation and measurements. Also, there are other difficulties of measuring aerodynamic parameters, because basically we would need to visualize the airflow and need to visualize and measure the effects of the air flowing around the body. And there are certain difficulties with that, but there are ways to go around it. What is the goal of the validation? Basically, the key part of the aerodynamic development is that you are preparing CFD simulations. And the CFD simulations are very complex simulations. They have, since we cannot really calculate the direct effect of the air, the direct way how the different air molecules are working, we cannot calculate all of them one by one, but we need to have some kind of physical models. And in most cases of CFD simulation, this is the Reynolds average Navier Stokes, the RANS runs simulation model. And these kind of simulations have a very complex setup, very, very many variables, and you need to have certain boundary conditions. So a CFD simulation can be set up in many, many different ways. And it can easily happen that what you are calculating is not with the certain variables that is necessary for your case, and what you are simulating is not really showing what is actually happening in reality. So because of that, when we set up our simulations, we need to know that it's gonna properly show the reality for us, and aerodynamic validation can help us to set up our simulation model properly. And then when we have a properly working simulation model, simulation scheme, then we can apply that to calculate for certain different aerodynamics package and design the car. So basically this is the primary goal of the validation, to show us that the simulation model that we are using is reflecting the reality of the car, and the development is based on the simulation itself and not by the testing and validation. There is a very basic idea, and that's something that I hear a lot, that okay, how do you validate your aerodynamics package? And many teams are saying that we send the car with and without aerodynamics package for a run. Of course, that sounds okay, but if you have a properly designed and complex car, which is designed to have the aerodynamics package, then you need to design the suspension accordingly, the rest of the bodywork accordingly. And if you're gonna take off the wings from such a car, it will become more unstable to drive. There will be reduced load on the tires, so the car will be like wobbly. It can be under steering or over steering. The frontal area will be reduced, so we can expect the drag to decrease. But at the same time, if you remove the front wing in front of the front tires, then the clear air will hit the rolling tires, and that will increase the drag. So it's really complex to see how the different values will change. because of these effects. And yeah, as I said, the front wing is very important to actually reduce the drag of the car, as it is removing the air from around the front tire. This is what is called the tire outwash. So it's really, really complex to determine what will happen in this kind of situation when we just simply remove the aerodynamics package, and what do we count as the proof that the aerodynamics package is working? What is that we consider as a failure? It's really not something objective, but at the end of the day, you can compare to your calculation results. And also it is very inconsistent. The driver cannot drive two times the same lap. So to take out in this kind of human error and the differences in the condition, like the changing wind or the changing air temperature and density, for to compensate for this, you would need to have multiple runs, a lot of runs, dedicate a lot of time with and without the aerodynamics package for driving. But as I said, there is not much time dedicated for aerodynamics testing, because of other components needs to be tested as well. So it's not really a good solution to try to validate the aerodynamics package like this. Another basic idea which would come into mind of a lot of people is to have wind tunnel measurements. It's a good idea, but there are certain difficulties with that. First and foremost, how do you access a wind tunnel? It might happen that your university have one, but most likely it doesn't have one. Even if it has one, it might be too small, because it would make sense to put the full car into the wind tunnel, because then you can measure directly the car. But the wind tunnel's measurement area must be pretty big. Here I show a picture of the Rimac Nevera in the wind tunnel testing. That's the car that we worked on. And you can observe that how huge is the wind tunnel compared to the car. This next to the car, there should be one more space for even one more car at least, but even more on the other side also, and above the car, like two times the height of the car or even more to have the sufficient clearance. Because if we are not having these huge buffers around the car, the boundary conditions of the wind tunnel, the friction on the wall and the other special boundary conditions will destroy our values, will destroy our measurement, and it's not going to be reliable. So because of that, we need huge wind tunnels, which are sufficiently big to put an actual race car in. And to eliminate this, many times the people who are using wind tunnels for car measurement, they are using scaled models. Even in Formula One, they are not putting the real size, the real life cars into wind tunnels, but they are making scaled models. But to make such a scaled model, it's extra effort from the team to build up the car in a smaller volume. It takes a lot of time and energy, and it's not gonna be some kind of simplified model, because you're not gonna create all the fasteners and everything in the smaller size. You're gonna use some simplifications, but then it's a question if it's comparable with the real car or not. So it is certainly very challenging to use wind tunnel with an actual car, and with a simplified scale model, it is a question that does it worth to make it. Besides this, it's also a problem that in the wind tunnel, you don't have it's very hard to get a wind tunnel where you can have when you can spin the tires of the car, because the tires are spinning. And in case of an open wheel car like Formula Student or Formula One, the effect of the rolling tire is a very significant effect on the aerodynamics performance. And to neglect this by just having the tires stationary, that's a big deformation of the values. And another factor is the moving floor. There should be some kind of conveyor belt running under the car, because of course, when you are driving the car, the floor around you is moving with the same speed as the wind. because actually the floor is standing, the air is standing, and your car is moving in this domain. In case of the wind tunnel, the car is standing, the air is moving, and to show the reality, the floor, the ground should also move with the same speed as the wind is moving. And because of that, in some labs, they are using some sliding in floor. For example, here in the middle, you can see that there is some conveyor belt running between the two tires. But of course, this is just the middle section of the car and not the sides of it, doesn't include tires also. So it's there are certain compromises that you are need to do if you're going for a wind tunnel. So to measure the complex car, there is one way to solve this moving floor. If you are putting two cars in the symmetrical layout next to each other, because in this case, because of the symmetry, that will represent that boundary condition of the moving floor in the same way. But to have this, you would have the car twice. And as I said, it's really not easy to make scale models or even the worst, a real model of the car and put it under the actual car and put it inside the wind tunnel, which is sufficiently big. So there are certain complications of putting the full car into the wind tunnel, but it can be a good solution for testing subsystems and also, as I said, to validate the CFD results. For example, you can build up a geometry of a certain subsystem and put it together in CAD and build it in reality in the wind tunnel as well. In CAD, you can create the geometry of how the measurement area looks like, and you can do simulations on that measured area, measure the volume, measured subsystem, and you can also do this measurement in the wind tunnel testing. And if you are running a simulation and running a measurement on the identical geometry, then you can compare your results directly with the CFD results. And based on that, you can validate your CFD model and can use it for to improve your simulation. So I would summarize it like this with the wind tunnel testing, that it's very beneficial to create some kind of specimens, to create some kind of test measurements in wind tunnel that you can use for validation. This is something that you can do at the beginning of the season. And to based on these tests, you can have a more reliable simulation. So this is something that the wind tunnel is good for. You can make a specimen, for example, of the front tires and the front suspension and the front wing. You can build up a small part of this. And here you can try to compensate with for the rolling of the tire. You can somehow make it sure that during the measurement, it's also rolling. If it's just the subsystem of the car, it's much easier to execute these special requirements than in case of the full-sized car. And because of that, the wind tunnel testing can work for this kind of validation very well. Now I would like to talk about a few easy validation techniques that you can do on the testing track during the test season of the car. And this is something that we are always looking for from the students when we are talking with the aerodynamic validation, because these are relatively easy to execute, and they are also giving some usable feedback on what you designed and if it's working according to your design. So the first test that I would like to say is the coast down test. It's when you're accelerating the car for a certain speed, and from that speed you engage the clutch and just let the car slow down by itself. Or in case of an electric car, you just simply switch off the tractive system, and you let the car to slow down by itself, and you are measuring the cover distance and the speed of the vehicle over time. And in this case, when the car is freely slowed down by the from a certain speed, there are two forces acting on the car. The one is the group of the mechanical forces and mechanical resistance. This is mostly consisting of the rolling resistance of the tires and the mechanical friction inside the car. If you are having an electric motor, of course, you're gonna, even if you switch on the electrical drive, there will be still a lot of rotating components inside the motor, and that will have a certain friction and certain resistance. Also, if you are having a combustion car, there are still the differential and still a lot of rolling components. This will have certain friction, but we can roughly say that this is indifferent of the speed. Of course, it's not completely true, but it's some certain simplification. But the other important force acting on the car besides these rolling resistance and the friction in the powertrain is the aerodynamic drag. And as we know, the aerodynamic drag is proportional to the square of the velocity. We all know the formula of the aerodynamic drag, and the velocity is on the power of 2. And if you calculate a theoretical curve, how the car should slow down because of these forces acting on it, you can see what is the theoretical curve that you are having. And you have the plot of the velocity over time as the car is slowing down, and you can fit a curve on it. The curve of the least squares fit on this velocity values, and you're gonna have a formula which have 3 coefficients depending on the velocity. And from these coefficients, you can derive your own values for drag and for the coefficient for the friction. So if you are fitting this curve and if you are getting these values, from these values, you can derive for yourself the drag coefficient of your car. And then if you have this drag coefficient, you can compare it with the drag coefficient simulated in the CFD. And this gives you the objective comparability. You're gonna have 2 numbers. One number is the drag coefficient coming from the testing, and another number is coming from the simulation. And then these 2 numbers are then objectively comparable. And as the velocity is proportional, the aerodynamic drag is proportional to the velocity square. Because of this, I really suggest to focus on the higher velocities. So accelerate around 100 kilometers an hour and let the car slow down by itself. And the values that you can focus the most can be the values from 100 to 70 kilometers an hour, because at this higher speed rate, at the higher speed, the aerodynamic force will be much more effective than the mechanical resistance. The mechanical resistance is significant in low speeds, where the aerodynamic drag is basically negligible. But on higher speeds, higher velocities, the aerodynamic drag will be the more prominent, and the mechanical resistance will be less prominent. And because of that, if you are basing your calculations on the higher velocities, you're gonna have more reliable results on the aerodynamic drag. The second measurement technique that I would suggest is to measure the spring displacement on the car. Also, you can, I often hear that the teams are putting some kind of measurement stamps on the push rod, pull rod. That's also possible. In that case, you can measure the elongation of these suspension rods, but that can be tricky. If it's carbon, it's probably not gonna move too much. There will be not much displacement. If it's metal, there is slightly more, but in this case, we are still measuring very tiny, a few tens of millimeters of displacement. While we are measuring the spring displacement with the linear potentiometers on the suspension, then we can have longer displacements, which gives us some better measurement accuracy, because the certain disturbances will be relatively small compared to the huge changes of the variable, like 2-3 centimeters. And in this case, you can have a better results. Of course, you need to take into account that there can be some certain disturbances in the measurement. The road surface can be really bumpy, and that can create a really fluctuating value. But if you have a large amount of data, you can apply some kind of filterings on it. And then you can have a roughly constant velocity of compression. And the compression of these springs are coming from mostly two factors. The one factor is the actual weight of the car. And you can measure what is the displacement just under the weight of the car if you are measuring this with zero velocity. Because in that case, the displacement will show the mass of the car. You can use this for calibration, that you are measuring the weight of the car with a scale, and also measure the weight of the car with this displacement. And you can set up that, okay, certain displacement is showing a certain kilogram values. And when you're driving the car, besides the actual weight of the car, there is also the downforce pushing down the car, which will result in this increased value of compression. And if you calculate these results, then you can compare it with the normal weight of the car. And besides the logging of this compression, the spring displacement, you also need to measure the velocity of the car, because just like the aerodynamic drag, the aerodynamic downforce is also proportional to the square of the velocity. And you need to have the pairs of velocity and compression values. And for that, you need to measure the velocity of the car. That can be a bit tricky, because you cannot really measure the velocity directly. You can log your GPS data, and based on the GPS data, you can derive what is the speed of the car if you are taking into account that, okay, the car was in this point at this time, at that point at that time, and you can just simply calculate the velocity if you are dividing the cover distance with the time need to cover it. So basically, derivation of the displacement of the actual cover distance of the car. That is one way to calculate the velocity. And another way is to have some kind of reading on the main shaft, that you can have some similar like the gears, but with those little tooth and little teeth all over the ring. And you can have a sensor which is basically counting as these teeth are passing in front of it with induction. And based on that, from the rotation of the wheel, you can calculate, knowing what is the diameter of the wheel and what is the rotational speed, you can calculate that what was the actual speed of the car. And the third thing is to integrate the acceleration values, because many cars have some kind of accelerometer mounted on it, which is measuring the acceleration in multiple directions. And that can be integrated over time, and that will also give you some speed values, some velocity values. And if you have these speed measurements from multiple sources, you can log them parallel with each other and compare them with each other. And then in the end, taking these into account, you can have a way to tell that what is the velocity of your car. And if you are having some runs and you are logging the compression, the spring displacement, and you're also logging the speed of the car, then you can, from that, you can calculate that what is the downforce of the car, downforce acting on the car. And to have proper measurements, I suggest to have straight direction runs with roughly constant velocity, because in this case, if you are not turning left or right, and if you are not changing your speed, accelerating and decelerating, but roughly keeping the same speed and the same direction, you can eliminate the load transfer when the weight of the car is moving between the different wheels, either left or right during cornering, or front and rear during braking or accelerating. And with this, you can have a roughly good approximation at what is the downforce acting on the front axle and what is on the rear axle. And with this, you can calculate the overall downforce acting on the car. From that, you can calculate the downforce coefficient, but you can also calculate what is the aerodynamic balance, how much of the downforce is on the front axle, how much of the downforce is on the rear axle, and what are these values on the different speeds. You can run it on 10 kilometers an hour, 20 kilometers an hour, 30, 40, 50. You can go in these different velocity regimes, and you can calculate the downforce value in all of these. And then after that, you can fit a curve on it, on these measurement results, and determine the downforce coefficient of your car. So based on these two measurements, you can have a downforce coefficient, an aerodynamic balance, and the drag coefficient of the car. And if you have these values, it's already a good validation method. And if you present this to the judges, that's basically, we can consider that the validation is done. And other than this, we can also have flow visualization techniques. Basically, the objective of this flow visualization is, again, to compare the simulation to the actual reality. Because in the simulation, you can know, you can detect that where is the part when the airflow is separating from the wing or from the aerodynamic surface. You can detect these separations where the pressure changes significantly. And also, if you are applying some certain paint, for example, this flow visualization paint, the way that it is moved around the car and as it dries over the time, you can observe what was the wing path is, what was the air's motion, and you can compare it with the results in your CAD simulation. And that's also one way to show that the CAD simulation was performing in a way that we expected it to perform. And another way of testing, which is quite popular in Formula Student, is to apply wool tuft. You can see that these tiny wool pieces are glued onto the relevant aerodynamic surfaces. This is a Formula Student car on the left. This is some Mazda, some actual car on the right, but these little wool tufts are glued to the car, and you can observe this motion, their motion over the different velocities, and you can see when the wool tuft is nice and straight, it shows that the air is flowing around it undisturbedly, but if it's going wobbling and going in a random motion, that indicates that the car, that at that point the flow has separated from the surface, and there is pressure fluctuation in that area, and that shows that the little wool tuft will not follow the nice straight line. For example, here in the middle you can see that these wool tufts here are separated, and probably the license plate is generating some separation bubble here, and the wool tufts are indicating that the separation bubble is disappearing here where the flow reattaches the car. So this with this wool tufts is a good way to also show that how is the flow pattern on the certain surfaces, and this is something that you can compare with the CFD directly. And another way is for the particle tracer methods. For example, in this picture, there is this smoke. This smoke, as it's flowing around the car, that is showing also that how is the air moving in that certain cross section and then certain location. We can trace how the air particle was moving in the along the car, and we can see that the ones coming from this lower following the car very tightly, while the ones on the top are less affected. They are roughly going in the same straight line, but of course they are slightly disturbed. The more we go away from the car, the less will be the effect of it. This is something that it's really challenging to do on the track, but the Wohltaft is something possible to execute. But of course, at this time, you need to mount some certain devices on the car, some kind of cameras, which are taking pictures of these Wohltafts during the run. And it's also tricky because it's also tricky from that point of view that you need to know the velocity of the car, because on a slower velocity, the flow will nicely follow the curvature. But as we increase the speed, these separations can appear. And to actually make it sure that you can compare the simulation with the actual run of the car, you would need to know that the car was driven on that certain speed on which you run the simulation. If it's 80 kilometers an hour that you are using for the simulation, or 50 something, then you would need to do this test on the exact same speed to make the results comparable with each other. And that is something challenging, but it can be done. You can do it like that again, that you are going in the straight line and with a certain speed. And at that point, you start to make pictures of the Wohltafts around the car. Basically, these were the measurement techniques that I wanted to explain. And I would like to say thank you. Thank for the UPB Aerotic Racing Team, the meme page of the aerodynamics team of University of Paderborn team, because they were creating some pictures that I showed in the beginning. And I want to say thank you for them to have these. These were the pictures that I found on their Instagram page. And if you have any questions, we can discuss them now.
Hello, Tomáš.
Hello.
I have a question about the ratio between downforce and the weight of aerobody kit. What is the best ratio?
The usual values that I hear about an aerodynamics package, that it's like 10 kilograms, 12 kilograms. Of course, it's an interesting question what you take into account. You calculate the whole, for example, if you have a diffuser under the car, if it's you take into account the whole mass or a whole mass of that floor, or you just take into account the front wing and the rear wing. But usually this roughly 10 kilograms is 10, 12, 15 kilograms is the average value of the aerodynamics package. It varies from team to team. And about downforce values, it's roughly like 50. It's hard to say, of course, it's depending on the speed as well. But I would say a few hundred newtons on the speed of 50, 60 kilometers an hour. But basically it's something that you need to check what is the relationship between the drag and the downforce of the car. Because to increase the downforce of the car, certainly you will increase the drag of it as well. And based on the vehicle dynamics simulations, on the lifetime simulations, you can derive an optimum point where the downforce is big enough to give you higher cornering speeds, but the drag is not that huge that is slowing you down in the straight line, and that is the point that you should achieve for. Of course, it's really hard to set it up for the first time when you don't really know what is the these downforce and the drag pairs, but over the time it can be iterated and you can find the optimum pair for your package.
And thank you. And as a question, many teams did the difficult aerodynamic body kits with something a little parts. And is it a good decision or maybe it's not so efficient and simple profile of thing it's enough for a formula student?
We can see how in the past few years it was the evolution, how it went through. And I'm pretty sure that those teams who are doing these aerodynamic packages for 5-6 years, they did accumulate a lot of knowledge. And if they are making these very complex geometries, they are doing it for a good reason. But of course, this is not something that you can do from day one, from the very beginning. In the beginning, of course, I would suggest to use some kind of basic, simple geometries, especially because they are much easier to manufacture. For example, a prismatic wing, which doesn't vary its profile in the lateral direction, but it's the same profile just extruded. That is something much easier to manufacture than something which is curved and changing its profile. That is a much more difficult stuff to manufacture. In case of an aerodynamic package, not that a team who is experimenting with this aerodynamic package for the first time, I would suggest to go with only front wing, rear wing, simple extruded geometry with the same constant profile over the wing. Of course, in the front, you can have multiple elements. You can have one basic element, which is going all across the car. And besides that, behind that, you can have certain small elements in front of the front tire to increase this outwash effect. And if you're making some similar geometry like this, that is good for practicing of the composite team, of the carbon composite manufacturing team, how to create these geometries, gain some experience. And when you have this experience, then you can think about what are the further steps. But at the beginning, I would suggest to go with just some kind of simple geometry.
Okay, thank you.
No problem.
And have other questions about aerodynamics for electrical vehicle. For example, it's our first car, electrical car. And is it need to use aerodynamics for downforce, or we can try to use aerodynamics for decrease drag and increase the efficiency?
Yeah, it's a valid question. It's something that you would need to get out from the lap time simulation. So in the lap time simulation, you can also, based on the lap time simulation, you can see that what can be your fuel consumption or electricity consumption. And if you see that, you can see what is the trade-offs. If you're gonna have higher drag to cover the distance of the endurance, you might need a larger amount of battery package. And if you are having smaller drag, then you might be able to reduce the battery package. But of course, the battery package will be also determined by the certain power that you need to get out of it. Because if you reduce the battery too much, it's not going to be able to provide that power, which is necessary for you. So ultimately, it depends on the parameters of the car. And of course, it's not going to be the aerodynamic package dominating this. You're going to know that, okay, what is the power that is accessible for us? And what is that largest possible downforce with that drag value, which is still acceptable for us? And then you can aim for that point. So you can have a strong ceiling that, okay, the drag shouldn't go over a certain level. But with that aerodynamic package, as I said, with the cleverly designed front wing, you are actually reducing the drag of the car because you are not really increasing the surface area, the frontal surface area that is increased by the rear wing. But the front wing is actually reducing the drag as it is removing the front tire from this direct airflow. But of course, if you are having the front wing, which is helping you in this way, you're going to have downforce on the front. And to maintain the good aerodynamic balance, you need to have a certain downforce on the rear wing as well. So ultimately, you're going to need to harmonize this package and make sure to keep it under the certain drag value. So to summarize the question, it is a complex iteration process, and it is something very important to take into account not to have too large drag for the car. But if you keep this into account, you can still focus to maximize the downforce with the certain limit on the drag.
Good afternoon, Tomas.
Hello.
My question is, which works better for stability in the turn, ducktail or rear wing?
Sorry? Which works better for?
Stability in the turn, ducktail or rear wing?
What is this duck? What kind of tail?
Spoiler.
He means the ducktail type of design. Do you know the Porsche race car called Moby Dick, racing in Le Mans?
That old Porsche. So it's either a diffuser or the rear wing. That's the question.
I'll try to show you.
So this one.
Yes, this one, but this one also have the rear wing. Can see the other example of, let's say, aerodynamic design is McLaren Speedtail model. Probably
yes,
you can also find it. So the question is, which one works better for handling stability in cornering?
Ooh, that's a very good question. From cornering stability, I don't really know. To be honest, I wouldn't like to give some answers that I'm not confident with. So I'm not really sure how this works in the cornering. But for sure, the objective of this was to keep the drag in a mannered way. And also they integrated that huge diffuser. The diffuser is good because it barely generates you any drag, but it can give you a substantial amount of downforce. For stability, the usual suggestion is to have the center of pressure, the relation between the center of pressure and the center of gravity is the important thing to take into account during the stability questions. And basically this is what you need to pay attention, that your that your center of pressure is in the place where the vehicle dynamics guys would like it to be. And you can observe that how do you need to set up your aerodynamics package to make this sure. This kind of tail is not really common in Formula Student. In Formula Student, they are mostly using regular rear wings. Basically, when they are making these bodyworks, their whole point is just to cover the engine or the machinery in the back. Because in Formula Student, there are no long tails like in these cars, where you need to have certain packaging as well for the trunk. But in Formula Student, you have a lot of switches, devices in the back, and basically their goal is to cover these, reduce the drag of these, and to have a wing which is as not they try to reduce the disturbance of these components on it, because of course in front of the rear wing you're gonna have the main hoop. On the main hoop you're gonna have certain switches. You can have the traction system, active light, and all these different components are generating turbulences and disturbances of the air. And with the rear wing, you can roughly manage this. But if you are using this kind of tails in Formula Student, it's going to be really challenging to make sure that the air is following these curvatures, because in Formula Student, you're not gonna have this smooth cabin surface, but you're gonna have the helmet of the driver. You're gonna have the rolling tires, which also disturb the flow. You're gonna have the main hoop, which is a tube, and behind the tube that you're gonna have also disturbed airflow. So probably making this kind of covers, this kind of tail design, it's not something that is that it's worth to make in Formula Student.
Okay, Tamás, may I jump in and also try to answer this question?
Okay.
From the vehicle dynamics point of view, it's let's say it's better for handling stability to have the rear wing, at least because it's easier to implement some adjustments in the rear wing design, because you can adjust the angle of attack and therefore affect the handling stability. So it's just easy. If you will have the rear wing, you can adjust your aerodynamic balance easily. It's easy to implement in your design. Therefore, you can directly test your vehicle and adjust the handling stability. In this type of design, it's much harder to implement. By the way, Tamás, may I ask the question?
Yes.
What is the main sources of inconsistency between the simulation and the reality? Maybe you can give some advices in terms of CFD simulation or modeling or any other tips on this.
Well, I'm not that huge expert in simulations, but for sure I can say that. As I said, there are many of these variables in case of CFD simulations, and the different models are working on different cases. And I would suggest to read a lot about vehicle aerodynamic simulations. You can find multiple theses online from former student team members who are publishing this kind of stuff. And you can also check the literature from the industry and check what are those turbulence models and simulation setups and boundary condition setups that they are typically using in vehicle applications, in automotive simulations. And I would suggest to check these and try to set up your simulations taking these into account, perform a certain mesh density, because this is ultimately a compromise. Also, your mesh needs to be detailed enough, but also not that huge to to take the calculation time, to extremely increasing the calculation time, because to have a good design, to have there actually it's some kind of iteration process that you're running multiple simulations, you're trying different geometries, and you would need to run a lot of simulations after each other. And you need to make sure that you have a mesh setup, which is making the simulation, the calculation time fast enough, but also it is detailed enough to give you results that you can use. For example, this is why we do something called the sensitivity analysis on the mesh, that you are running the simulation with a very high element number, and then you are decreasing the element number with the same geometry, run the simulation again, then also decrease the element number, and you do these steps multiple times, and you're gonna see at which point the results starts to be disturbed. What is that mesh density? From what the results are start to deviate. Because theoretically, if you're running for the same boundary conditions, for the same model setup, if you're running it over and over, the results should be the same. But at some point, the quality of the mesh will start to affect these values. And when you see that point that, okay, the mesh is now so rough that it's disturbing the values, that's the point from where you don't need to make the mesh more rough. But the point before that point, if you are too much increasing the mesh density, it's gonna just make your calculation unnecessarily slow. So that is an important, so it can be an important source of difference that the mesh is set up properly. And another thing can be also the calculation. As I said, even during the coast down test and also during the when you're measuring the spring displacement, there can be certain disturbances. And that will cause some kind of deviations between the results and the measurement results and the CFD results. But of course, you need to solve some kind of correlation in between them. And if you see big differences, then you can analyze in the given case that what can be the source of this difference.
Okay, thank you. Sure, what else is?
Okay, seems like no more questions.
Okay,
and, then. I remember that you mentioned that you can say something about your current job.
Yes, Andrei mentioned me that Rimac Automobili is not that known in Russia. And I can talk about it a bit. So actually I'm living in Zagreb and I'm working for Rimac Automobili, which is a small, relatively small company. And I'm working on designing cars, but let's go into the details. So Rimac Automobili is a company which was established in 2010. And it was established by a young Croatian entrepreneur called Mate Rimac. And at the time when he established the company, he was 22 years old. And it all started like that he had a BMW that he used for drifting. And once he blew up his engine and he wanted to buy some very strong V8 engine to put it in and to use it for dragging again. But he found that it's really expensive to buy that engine. And in the end, he decided to implement some kind of electrical drivetrain in the car. Because of his studies, he had some certain experience with electrical drives. So basically they turned this BMW into electric by putting some forklift engine into it and building a battery. And then he used it for testing. This was the first major project of the company. And this was the time when it was established and a few employees were hired for this project. And after that, this is Mate. This is now, this picture was taken just a few years ago. At this time he was 30. And this was basically 2 years ago, 3 years ago. And the first product after these drifting drifting project. And at that point, the goal of the company was to convert cars. But at some point, they saw that there is an opportunity to develop a full car. And this was the time when Tesla was slowly starting to take off. At this time, Tesla was making the Tesla Roadster, and they started to come out with the Model S. And the world started to notice that, okay, electrical drivetrain might make sense. And this was also the time when the diesel scandal came up with the Volkswagen Group. And this was the paradigm shift when they saw that, okay, these old IC technology have some certain problems with it, which led to this diesel scandal of Volkswagen. But at the same time, there is a way to make electric cars fun and exciting and usable. Tesla showed this. And luckily, Rimac at this point was already working and managed to jump on this opportunity. And the company made this car called Concept One. This was the first electrical hypercar. And this was something really complex car. It was basically all of them made like a former student car, that not like a serial produced car, but like individually handcrafted, because it has a huge tubular structure, and it took crazy amount of time to manufacture one single car. But this was some kind of first project, and it was a starting point for the company after that, after the BMW conversion. And parallel with the development of the C1, the Concept One, the team also made some kind of side projects. And for example, one side project was to make this race car by Tajima, Japanese car racer, to develop this electrical car for him for the Pikes Peak. And on that year, this car was the champion in Pikes Peak, and with the electric drive, it was performing very well, especially because in Pikes Peak, when the cars are running up for the high hills, over the time, as the pressure drops, the performance of the combustion car is also dropping. And for the electric car, this is something which doesn't matter. It even on higher altitude, the engine will perform in the motor will perform in the same way. So it has a huge advantage compared to combustion cars. And after these tiny projects, this beginning project, after the Concept One, the company started to focus on the next big project. And it started in 2015-16. And this was the then called Rimac C2, Concept Two. But later it started to call it like the Nevera. This is the current flagship project of the company. Basically, this is the evolution of the Concept One. It's a electrical driven car. The performance is almost 2,000 horsepower, 1,940 horsepower, and it has four different wheels in four different motors. In each wheel has its own independent motor. So it has a front powertrain and the rear powertrain. And this car was introduced. This car is actually getting manufactured now. Over the past few years, we were working on this. And now is the time when we start the production of this. During this summer, it was the launch of it when the company released a video about it, actually, that how is it performing. That was the time when we announced the numbers, and that was the time when we started to take the orders for the car. And now we are manufacturing the first prototypes, the first actual customer cars. And we're gonna have 150 of these cars over the next few years. And basically in the past 5 years, this was the most important thing that the company focused on. But other than this, we also had side projects, just like the Tajima project. But instead of having these single projects when we are just working on one car, we increased the size. And now we are supplying the battery technology and the batteries for the Koenigsegg Regera. and also the battery for the Aston Martin Valkyrie. And besides the battery system for the Aston Martin Valkyrie, we are also supplying the infotainment system. So basically, this is the current model of the company, that we are making a few cars, which are basically a flagship of our technology, which is showing our capabilities in electrical powertrains and other electrical systems like the infotainment or the autonomous driving support systems. Basically, our vehicles like the Nevera is the showcase of this technology, and it's available in limited numbers. But the other source of income and other focus is to have these customer projects and gradually going from smaller volumes like these projects like the Nevera, like the Regera and the Valkyrie, to go into bigger projects which will contain like a few hundreds of thousands of components. For example, supplying a car which is widely available, let's say, for example, the Mercedes S-Class, and supplying the battery for such vehicles. That is our current project besides our own cars. Parallel with the Nevera, we also worked with Pininfarina, because Pininfarina came out with this car, which is called the Battista. What we would need to know about this car, that basically underneath the skin, it's also like the Nevera. So the rolling chassis, the monocoque structure and the powertrain and the cooling and the electrical systems is almost completely identical to the Nevera. Basically, they are like brothers to each other, sisters. And the exterior and interior is made by Pininfarina, and they are selling this car under their own network, but it's strongly related to the Nevera. And in 2018, when I joined the company, at that time was the Nevera was shown in Geneva. It was still called the C2, but it was just in the middle of the development process. At that point, we had the CAD of the, we had the basic design of the car and the basic functionalities and the targets set up for ourselves. And that at that point they introduced the car to the public, but the development continued. And as I said, we are finishing it this year, and it's going to production currently. But besides this development process, we also got investments. In 2017, there was a huge Chinese battery cell manufacturer called Camel Group, which joined in the company. They bought some shares, and they had some investment. And at that point, the company had like 300 employees. And at that point in late 2017, they announced 100 new open positions. And that was the time when I also joined the company and dropped in the middle of this Nevera development. And in 2018 also, Porsche decided to invest into the company. And this was some huge news for us and a huge gesture for us, because Porsche never did this before, that they invested in some kind of automotive technology company. And we were the first, and we were really proud that we earned this respect from Porsche, that they wanted to join our project. So Porsche decided to invest into the company, and not much after that, also Hyundai joined us, and currently the company is owned in 22% by Porsche and 11% by Hyundai. 35% is still Mate's property, and the rest is like the smaller investors like Camel Group. Also, some other employees are shareholders of the company, and this is how the ownership structure comes together. So it was a huge step for us when we had these partnerships with Porsche and Hyundai. We are also working on other projects with them. We are developing batteries for them, and that's the that's what actually most of our employees are working on in this technology department. We call it the components department, the components engineering, where they are designing these electrical components, mostly batteries, but also infotainment and powertrain systems for our partners. And after these huge investments, parallel with the development of the vehicles, we also, and the batteries, the company also decided to build a new campus. This will be in the vicinity of Zagreb, in an empty field that where we are building up this huge manufacturing plant and also this development center. It's going to be something similar like the campus of McLaren in Woking. I would imagine something like that. And in the next 2 years, this will be built. Currently, it's in construction. And in 2023, at the beginning of 2023, we're going to have a product that we would like to manufacture in this factory. So by that time, the campus will be ready and we're going to move in. And the latest news which came this year is that Porsche was looking for the future for the Bugatti brand. And basically what they realized that the future of Bugatti is certainly switching towards electrification and to go from this huge monstrous combustion engine to reposition themselves in a more electric drivetrain. And that parallel with these strategical thoughts, these Porsche investments happened in Turimats. And in the Volkswagen Group, they restructured the Bugatti brand and they give it to Porsche. And Porsche eventually gave it to us. And because of that, starting from this, actually the 2nd of November, it was this Tuesday when we started to have like that, the company is now split into two entities. The Rimac Automobili will become the Rimac Group, which will have the shareholder structure that I said before, 35% on Mate, 22% on Porsche, 11% on Hyundai and 32% on other investors. But the Rimac Group is splitting into the Rimac Technology, which will be 100% owned by the Rimac Group. And this technology will continue to make these battery systems and powertrain systems and infotainment systems and also other electrical systems for our OEM partners. And the other side of the company, which was the former vehicle engineering and the former departments which are working on our own products, our own hypercar products, will become part of Bugatti Rimac. And the other part of this Bugatti Rimac will be the current Bugatti brand from the Volkswagen Group. We're gonna receive that and we're gonna have development center for this Bugatti Rimac will be here in Zagreb. Actually, it's the same location where right now the headquarters of Rimac Automobili is. And over the time, the headquarters of this Bugatti Rimac brand will be in the campus that I showed on the previous picture, this one. And this Bugatti Rimac brand is 50%, 55% owned by the Rimac Group. And another 45% is the ownership of Porsche. And as I said, the headquarters and the development will be in Zagreb, but also we're gonna have a development center for the current Bugatti employers who are actually Volkswagen employers. They are working in Wolfsburg in the Volkswagen headquarters. There we're gonna establish a smaller company, the German branch of the company, and they're gonna work from there, but the actual headquarters will be in Zagreb. And the manufacturing for the Rimac cars will stay in Zagreb. And we're gonna continue to have this Rimac brand manufacturing the Nevera and the further cars. But also the Bugatti will continue to be manufactured in Molsheim, France, next to Strasbourg. And basically this is what we're gonna have. We're gonna have this one company developing cars for these two brands, working in Zagreb, but doing this manufacturing split between Molsheim and Zagreb. And yeah, basically, this is what I wanted to say. Currently, this Rimac Group is containing 1,200 employees. As I said, when I joined, it was almost 4 years ago, it was 350. So it's a quite dynamically growing company. And we are constantly looking for new employees. And I have to say that this is a very good opportunity for former student team members, because there are a lot of key people in the company who was involved in the Formula Student project of Zagreb. For example, the test driver in our company, who is the test driver for the Rivas Nevera, and who is very important role in the testing and development process of the Nevera, that employee was the founder of the team of Zagreb. And because of that, a lot of the team members who are coming from Zagreb, they have a good connection towards the company, and it's really easy for them to come in to join the company. But also from other former student competitions, if you mention that you were involved in former student, you're not going to need to explain for this company that what former student is, because they already know, they already benefited a lot from it. And it's something well respected here, and it's a good opportunity. And about the internationality, from this 1,200 employees, roughly 80% is Croatian, but 20% is from different countries. And there is a quite large number of foreigners. And within that, we also have Eastern Europeans. And I also know about a few Russian colleagues. For example, I know about one guy who is in the vehicle styling department. But also, if I'm right, there are some other roles as well where we have Russian employees. So it's quite popular for these Eastern European, from these Eastern European countries to come to Rimac as well. And right now, as I said, we are working on the manufacturing of the Nevera. Parallel with us, the Bugatti is manufacturing the Chiron. And just recently, we started to work on the successor of the Chiron. As this new company now, the Bugatti Rimac, started to operate, we are working on the successor for the Chiron.
Amazing. It's a good story, actually.
Thanks.
As I know, Rimac support a new event, and a former student event in Croatia.
Yes.
Am I right?
Yes, there is that former student Alpe Adria. It's a small competition. It has been started to organize 4 years ago, and now they organize the third edition of it. So it's a relatively new competition, relatively young competition. It was roughly established at the same time as former student Russia. And Rimac is heavily involved in that. They are the naming sponsor. And what I'm working on now is that I would like to contact Rimac Automobili or the Rimac Group with former student East as well.
Okay, great. I guess still no questions from the students.
Okay.
Okay, so according to the schedule, we have 4 minutes left, and maybe you can see give some advices for our teams in general, in terms of what you see during the design event when you judge our team. So maybe some feedback.
Well, regarding aerodynamics, as I said, I would suggest to keep it simple, start to work on it. And there is a huge there are quite differences. Some teams are already doing it for years now. Some teams are just experimenting with it. Those who are working on it for a few years, they for sure have the some certain experiences. And based on that, I would suggest just to iteratively improve year to year and have first simple designs. And as you see them working and as you can see that, okay, what we are designing is actually getting implemented in the car and actually working, as we said, this is the part where the validation comes in, that you need to see that what is actually happening on the car is correlating to your simulation data. And if you are confident about this, then you can experiment with certain other geometries. You can implement more and more components. For example, in the beginning, you can just have a front wing and a rear wing. But if you see that it's already working, you can think about to introduce something like the bull wing. I can show it. So this is the bull wing, if you see where I'm pointing. That little wing in front of the rocker. So this little wing is making sure, as it looks, it's generating actually lift, not downforce, but it's generating lift on this car at this location. But as it is affecting the airflow, it is making sure to supply better quality air for the rear wing. So basically locally here is generating some upward pointing force, but over the time it will make sure that the rear wing is generating more downforce. So if you have an already reliable aerodynamic package, you can start to implement these kind of fine tunings to it, which are making sure that it's even better. You can add more elements to your wing. You can do some experiments with other end plate solutions, certain cutouts on them, certain wing elements. Also, you can use this kind of side wings next to the car, or a huge diffuser underneath the car. So you can make your design more and more detailed. But first, the goal would be to have a first reliable and a simple design. And if you have that reliable basic design, you can further step into more complex geometries. You can start to experiment with these variable profiles and see if it works or not. And you can also improve this kind of small aerodynamic elements over the car. And iteratively, you can get more and more detailed design. And this is the trend that you can see on the big teams as well, that a few years ago, like 4 or 5 years ago, they had really simple basic design. And year by year, it's getting more and more detailed, more and more components, and more and more sophisticated design. It's an interesting question that what is that worth it? But for sure, it's worth to start to work on it. And over time, you can see that what is the benefit of a certain change. What is the difficulties of manufacturing it and putting it into the car? And you can make decisions based on this, that what is what it brings and what is the cost of it, the human and the temporal cost and the money cost as well.
Okay, Tamás, it seems like no more questions from the students. And I want to say a big thank you for your lecture. It was useful and interesting. I hope to see you in the future, the next events, maybe in Hungary, maybe in Russia, who knows?
Yes, thank you very much. I like to present again, and I'm back again. I was here last year and I'm here now. I really like to participate in these events, and I'm happy if I could provide some useful information. And thanks for the opportunity, and wish you all the best for the rest of this workshop and all the best for the forthcoming season and the development process.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.